Greetings, blessings to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ on this Sunday evening. Once again, this is David Jones, More Excellent Ministries. Delighted to come before you on this evening to share with you from the scriptures the word of the living God. Praise the Lord. I pray that your week has been a blessed and a safe week, and that you are staying safe in all of his ways, and you are still rejoicing in what God has done and is doing in your life. Here at More Excellent Ministries, we do celebrate the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. So tonight, once again, it is our virtual communion. The reason why we participate in this holy sacrament is to honor and to memorize the death and burial of the Lord Jesus Christ. So before we go into the communion part of this tonight, I want to share with you what God is doing in my life, and I pray that what he's doing in your life. Now, on December 31st, the New Year's Eve, I preached a message entitled, "This Is Your Year for a Presentation." And I pray that you have received your presentation, because I certainly have. The year is not over. There's still a few months left to the year, but I believe that there is a presentation being dispersed to the body of Christ. I believe that God has a special gift for you, a present specifically inscribed with your name. And if you believe that tonight, then there's a presentation for you. God is a great God. He's an awesome God, and he's giving out gifts, the Bible says. He's passing out these extraordinary blessings to the people of God, to those who would trust and believe in him and to walk by faith. I want you to be encouraged that there is a presentation for you. Stay strong in the faith. Believe God. Trust God. Before this year ends, you will receive your presentation. If you believe that, type amen in agreement with me concerning your presentation. The Bible records that on the night of Christ's betrayal, that he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke the bread and said, "Take, eat. This is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." He was instituting a very important sacrament in which we call Holy Communion. It is not the Passover, as we some suppose, but he instituted a New Testament written in his blood. Paul began to expound by divine revelation to the church at Corinth concerning the institution or the Holy Communion. And he begins by saying, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that on the same night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you.'" He said, "Do this in remembrance of me." The body represents, or the body, the bread represents his body, which was broken for us in those dreadful hours when Christ was led from Pilate's praetorium, the judgment seat, in which he carried his own cross up the Via Dolorosa to Golgotha's hill. And not only that, we must keep in mind that in the Garden of Gethsemane, Christ began to intercede for us. The Bible says that he prayed so earnestly that the blood from his forehead became great drops of blood. The sweat turned into blood because of the capillaries, or the capillaries began to burst in and he began to shed his blood. We do this in remembrance. It is something that we should do often to reflect on what Christ did for us on the cross. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, the new testament in my blood." He said, "This do as often as ye drink it." When God cuts a covenant or he makes a testament, he always ratifies it and conceals it with blood. He says, "For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show forth the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread and drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord." We have often been told that we cannot partake of the Holy Communion if we have a consciousness of sin. But Paul was not referring to someone having sin in their life. He was referring to a lack of discernment, a lack of understanding and knowing what we are doing. That this institution, the bread representing his body, the cup representing his blood. So it begins to say, "But let a man examine himself." In other words, to examine myself, to have an understanding of what I'm doing. "And then let him eat of this bread and drink of this cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body." So it all goes back to the discerning of the Lord's body. The bread, his body, the cup represents the New Testament that has been sealed in his blood. "For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many have fallen asleep. If we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we may not be condemned with the world." This is a holy moment. This is between you and God. It's not between me and you. It's not between anyone else. This is your moment to get it right with God. Paul said, we ought to do this until he comes. Do you not know that he is coming? The question is, will you be ready? Will you be ready to stand before the Son of Man and give an account for your life? Now is the time to reconcile ourselves to God through the body and the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. After we expire and we transition, there is no more time to reconcile. There is no more time to repent. We will stand before the Son of Man naked, exposed, and we will give an account for our life. So we have here the cup that represents his blood, and we have the bread that represents his body. These two natural elements, I believe, when we pray over these elements, we are actually implementing ourselves with the body and blood of Lord Jesus Christ. We are partaking of his sufferings, we are partaking of his death, and we are partaking of his resurrection. So, Father, we thank you for the body and the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for sending your Son to die on the cross for the remission of our sins. And at this hour, we confess that we stand in need of a Savior. We stand in need of salvation. And we ask that you would Forgive us. Cleanse us from all sin, all iniquity, all transgressions that we have committed against you knowingly and unknowingly. And that you would wash us now. Bathe us in the precious blood of the Lamb. If there's anyone who needs healing, I pray tonight that they would receive their manifestation of healing in their bodies. I pray that the anointing of God would descend upon their life and to bring healing, to bring restoration, to bring joy, to bring peace, to bring comfort wherever they may be. As we come to this table, we come undeserving of anything. So we empty ourselves out tonight as much as we can. And we humbly come before you with the body and the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And they all ate the bread. And they drank the cup. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's go into the word of God for this evening. I believe that God has to say something to us. This particular message I struggled with because there are some messages that come forth in a way that some will not understand. They will not agree with. They will not fully follow. So there are times when the Lord begins to impress upon me certain messages that I tend to shy away from. However, this message, I tried to pull away from it, but I kept coming back to it because the anointing was on these particular texts. This is a deliverance ministry. And every now and then, I have to talk about things that we don't want to hear. A lot of people shy away from words like Satan, demons, devils. It's because they are afraid of that unknown realm. But in the deliverance ministry, it must be talked about. Because there are people who are unknowingly bound. Paul told the church, let us not be ignorant of Satan's devices. And if anything, the enemy wants us to do is to be ignorant of what he's doing. He hides in darkness, not to be seen. He does not want to be exposed by the truth or the light of knowledge. So he hides in certain areas of our life undetected until he is exposed by the word of God. So this message tonight is entitled The Serpent's Attack on the Male Image. The Serpent's Attack on the Male Image. Two Sundays ago, I teached about the bronze serpent. And here it is 2 weeks later, I'm still on the serpent topic. So the Bible begins, the text I began to follow was Romans. Romans chapter 11. Excuse me, chapter 1, verse 21 through 23. So I'm going to read it. And there's also another text, Genesis 3 and 1. So we have two texts I'm going to go back and forth on. Romans chapter 1, 21 and 23, and Genesis 3 and 1. Listen to what Paul was writing to the church at Rome. He says here, and he's talking to the Gentiles, the unheathen, the heathens nations, the nations that are without God. He's talking to the unsaved. He's not talking to the church. He's delivering a message about those who are in Rome who are unsaved. And he begins to tell the church at Rome, and he says, because although they knew God, meaning that the world has a knowledge, a superficial knowledge of God. So he goes on and he says, although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God. They did not give him the proper recognition as God. God was simply something to say. God was just something that they would use to please their agenda on what they were trying to do. Nor were thankful, but became futile, became vain in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools. Verse 23 says, and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man, and birds, and four-footed beasts, and creeping things. And there's a lot there I want to talk about. So much information. And I believe we do have time. Listen to what Paul says. Apostle Paul is writing to the church of Rome, declaring to them their need for the righteousness of God. So he speaks to the church, informing them that we need to be saved. They need to be saved. We stand in need of a savior. And he begins his dissertation by confronting the Gentiles of his time and their need for salvation. He begins by saying in chapter 1, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth, who hold down the truth in unrighteousness. In other words, they know God. They know he's real. They know he exists, but they hold him down for the sake of their well-being or their agenda. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him, God, nor were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations. Their imagination was vain. It was futile. They were on a mission that would end in destruction. They had an agenda or a narrative that would not profit them in the end. And their foolish heart, I want you to memorize, and I want you to get this word foolish and write it down, because I'm going to minister on this word foolish in a few minutes. Their foolish hearts were darkened, which means their heart did not receive knowledge, wisdom, and understanding of God. It was dark. It was in a place of ignorance. And they had no relationship with God Almighty. Professing themselves to be wise. Now, they call themselves wise, but according to the Bible, they are not, because God says that they are fools because, watch this, they change the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Now, Paul didn't actually write this. Listen to what Paul says. He says, and they changed the glory of the immortal God, the God of immortality that dwells in light, into a likeness of an image of mortal man and birds and quadrupeds and creeping things. That's what Paul wrote. Now, we know that a four-footed beast, well, some know that a four-footed animal would be a quadruped. Something that would be three, a triangle, would be a tri or a triunity or a triangle. But he said quadrupeds, and he did not say four-footed beast. Now, I don't want to go in that direction, but the King James translators put four-footed beasts. Watch this. Genesis now, he says here, let's go to Genesis. Genesis 3 and 1. Because this is where it all begins, in the Garden of Eden. This is where it all takes place. The situation that we are in today still exists. Nothing's changed. Let's see what verse 1 says in chapter 3 of Genesis. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field. Now wait right there, because see, this is what we have not fully understand of who or what this serpent was. Because our minds, and we've been taught that the serpent was a snake. But the Bible is not saying that he was a snake. Listen to what it says. He says the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field. Now, snakes don't live in fields. Snakes live in climates that are wet, moist, near rivers. But this serpent, watch this, was like a beast. He says this. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field. The Hebrew word is called nakash, meaning more cunning, the arum, than any beast with a K. The serpent meant to hiss, like a snake. So this beast of the field was not a serpent or a snake like you and I think it was. God is saying that this beast of the field hissed like a snake. All right? The word cunning means subtile or crafty. This beast of the field was subtile and it was crafty. This beast of the field was a four-footed animal. Snakes don't have legs. Now, I've heard theories that after God cursed this animal, it lost its legs. I'm not going to argue with that. But prior to God cursing the serpent, this thing was a beast. The serpent was not a snake as we know it today. It was a beast that lived in a field, and before it was cursed, it walked on all fours. Walked on all fours. Listen to what God says. Now the Lord God said to the serpent, now this is after the fall, meaning after the serpent had deceived Eve, the serpent and Eve and Adam stood before the Lord God, and this is what God said to the serpent. He says, you are cursed more than all cattle. All right. You're cursed more than all cattle. Cattle, we would call today cows, which is a beast, which has four legs, which is a quadruped. So whatever this beast or this animal looked like, it lived amongst cattle. It was a four-footed beast that hissed more than all. He says more than every beast of the field. Now this is when God pronounces the curse. He says, on your belly you shall go, and you shall eat the dust all the days of your life. So this is where the theologians and scholars says that he lost his legs, and now it's the snake. Because a snake has no legs, and now it must eat the dust of the field all of its life. The scripture says, and the serpent said to the woman, let's go to Genesis. The serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which God had made, and he said to the woman, this was Eve, Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of the tree or every tree of the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it. We know the story. Nor shall you touch it, lest you die. Verse 4 says, and the serpent said to the woman, you will not surely die, for God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Now listen to Eve having this conversation with this beast-like serpent in the Garden of Eden. She was talking to him in a conversation. And the voice that came from this beast made a hissing sound when it talked. She was having a conversation with the devil. She was talking to the devil. Now listen, Satan was in the garden, or was here on earth before the garden was ever created. He was cast out of heaven eons and eons of eternity. And when he descended to the earth, by the time he hit the earth, the Bible says that the earth was void and it was chaos and it was out of form. It was empty. Jesus said, I saw Satan fall like lightning. In other words, when he fell so hard from heaven that he shook the entire atmosphere of not only heaven, but the entire universe. Now, this was the angel, the highest of all angels. The Bible says that his name was called Lucifer, son of the morning, the most brilliant, brightest angel God had ever created. A war broke out in heaven because Lucifer began to look at himself. He began to notice how well he was crafted, how well he shined. The instruments were built inside of his body. He led the choir, and he began to watch this, look at himself, and he began to want praise and worship. He saw how the heavenly host was praising and worshiping God, and he wanted them. So a fight broke out in heaven. The angels fought with the devil's angels, and they were cast down to the earth. The Bible says one third of the angels were cast down the earth by the tail of the serpent. I'm going to go into detail about the tail of the serpent. So when he was cast down out of heaven, he lost glory. Because glory is a reflection. In other words, we reflect the glory of God. So when he fell from the presence of God, he lost that reflection. He lost the glory, and now he is darkness. This is what happens when we are in the presence of God. We reflect his glory. The glory that is on him bounces out of our spirit and reflects. When we are not in the presence of God, darkness begins to come in our soul. The Bible says we were dead in sins. That's darkness. That's alienated from the life of God. So when he lost the glory and he fell to the earth, he became darkness. There's no glory within him. He is complete darkness. Not only did he lose the glory, he lost the name Lucifer, and now he is Satan or Satan. We cannot call him Lucifer because Lucifer was the name that was given to him as a son of God. And because he is no longer a son of God, he does not have the title Lucifer. He is now Satan, or the correct pronunciation is Satan, or the adversary. Let's go forward. And the serpent talked to the woman. Notice he talked to Eve and he did not talk to Adam. He talked to Eve, but he didn't talk to Adam. Listen to this. Adam knew the voice of God, because when they both sinned and fell, God came through the garden and he said, "Adam, where art thou?" He did not say Eve and Adam. He specifically spoke to Adam because Adam knew his voice. Eve listened to another voice. She heard the voice of God. She knew the voice of God because she says, "God has said we shall not eat of the tree of knowledge." But now she is listening to another voice, which was the hissing voice, the serpent's voice. This voice began to speak to her about this tree of knowledge of good and evil. Now watch this, because we've been told that he lied to her in the Garden of Eden. No, he didn't lie. Listen to what he said. And the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die." She didn't die. She lived hundreds of years. He says, "For God knows that when you eat of this tree, your eyes will be open to know good and evil, and you will be like a God." You will be like God, knowing good and evil. Watch this. The serpent sent a signal to the woman that God had made. Satan was very much acquainted with Eve, not Adam. He knew her rhythm. He knew her vibes. He knew what she liked. He knew what she liked to hear. He studied this woman. The Bible doesn't put a time on it, but he studied her so well that he knew that she liked to talk. He knew this woman enjoyed conversation like most women. He knew what motivated her, knew what inspired her. Now, the Bible doesn't say whether Adam wasn't talking to his wife or not, but he knew that if I could just talk to her long enough, I will get her attention. And this is what women need to know. You are listeners. You listen. You listen to a man. You'll listen to your father. You'll listen to any male image, because you are a listener by nature. Not a bad thing. Women love to communicate. They love to talk. Women are feelers. They feel more in touch with their emotions than the man. Men, we shy away from conversation. We shy away from talking. We're not much to talk, but women are. And he knew this. So now he engages a conversation. It doesn't say how long it lasts. It could have been a day. It could have been a week. It could have been a month. This could be going on for years, but there was some type of conversation going on between the woman and the devil. He knew how to send a signal to her, an impulse to her emotional intellect, and he knew what she liked. He knew a rhythm, but he could not talk to Adam because Adam was listening to God's voice. He only heard one voice, not two. What? Watch this. The text says, and the Lord God called to Adam and said to him, where art thou? He called to Adam, not both of them. He called to Adam because Adam knew his voice. Eve was listening to another voice. And the serpent said to the woman, has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden of Eden? And the woman said to the serpent, we may freely eat of all the trees except the tree of knowledge, knowledge of good and evil. And the serpent said, you will not surely die. He did not lie to her, for God knows in the day that you eat, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Listen to what the original text says. Your eyes then will be opened, knowing like God, good and evil. The tree of knowledge. What were their eyes open to? Prior to this happening, the spirit realm was closed. No one could see in the realm of the spirit. When Eve was deceived by the serpent and she gave of the fruit to her husband, Adam, their eyes were opened to the spirit realm and they heard the voice of the devil. The spirit realm has been closed. And this is what's going on today. You have people in the body of Christ searching and seeking out spiritual things, wanting to see in the realm of the spirit. Let me give you a word of caution. You do not want to see in the realm of the spirit. There are voices in the realm of the spirit. Unless God shows you something, that is nothing to tap into. But Eve tapped into it. Because she wanted to know. Watch this. Your eyes then will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. In other words, that realm, only God had the authority to see both the natural realm and the spirit realm. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes and desirable to make one wise, she took of this fruit and ate. Watch this. The tree was, number one, good for food. Number two, pleasant to the eyes. And three, a tree desirable to make one wise. Here comes the knowledge. Here comes the false knowledge. Here comes the knowledge that's from the forbidden tree. And this is what I want to talk to you tonight about, this false knowledge and this wisdom that is not of God. One will be wise. Where does this wisdom come from? This wisdom that we were forbidden to have, this knowledge that we were forbidden to partake of. Listen to what James 3 and 15 says. This wisdom descends not from above. You can read it for yourself, but is earthly, sensual, demonic. It is the Greek word Sophia, meaning a higher or lower worldly spiritual wisdom. For where there are envy and self-seeking exists, confusion and every evil thing will be there. This is the wisdom that he gave to her. Oh, wait a minute. When Satan fell, he didn't lose his powers. See, we think that the enemy is powerless. That's not what the Bible says. He still has every single power that he had in the beginning. The difference is his power and his wisdom has now been corrupted by sin. The Bible never says that the devil is powerless. The Bible teaches that there is a power greater than him. And that power is found in God alone. The devil still has his power. Death still has its power. People are still dying. People are still getting sick. So the enemy still has just as much power as he had from the beginning. The difference is it's now corrupted. The wisdom that he had in the beginning is now demonic. And this is in the tree of knowledge of good and evil. 1 Corinthians 1:7 says, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise. This is God speaking. And bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. God says he's going to destroy the wisdom of the wise. What wisdom? This wisdom that comes from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. This knowledge that comes from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now, the Bible teaches that we should pursue or go after and gain knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. But he's talking about the heavenly wisdom, not the wisdom of this world, not the knowledge of this world. Because when we go after the wisdom and knowledge of the world, we are eating, partaking of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. See, in the garden, God had everything laid out for Adam and Eve. They had everything they could want. They had everything they needed. Everything was being supplied to them. Why did she want more? She wanted to know. And this is the problem that we have today as Christians. We want to know. We want to know before we go. We want this knowledge. We don't trust him. We just want to know. So when God came through the garden and he said, where art thou? Watch this. He says, where art thou? And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden, and he called to Adam and he said, where are you? And he said, I heard your voice in the garden and I was afraid. And because I was afraid, I was naked and I hid myself. And watch this. God says to him, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to? In other words, who you been talking to, Adam? Who you been talking to that told you was naked because I did not tell you was naked? You're listening to another voice. God never told them they were naked. They were clothed with the anointing of God that was so heavy, they didn't know themselves that they were naked. Listening to another voice. So he got angry with them and said, why did you eat from the tree of knowledge? Why do you got to know so much? Why do you have to always try to connect the dots? Why? We won't go unless we know. We won't sow unless we want to receive something. We have this torn voice going on with us. We're torn. We're still listening to another voice. Let me give you a perfect example. God does something and the first thing we say is, Lord, is that you? Was that God? Speak to me, Lord. Give me a sign. See, torn. Still eating from the tree of knowledge of good and evil because we don't know his voice. And if we do know his voice, we're listening to that serpent's voice. And all our life, we're torn between two voices. God's voice and the serpent's voice, because he's still hissing in our ears. We can't discern between the two. So therefore, we put God on the spot and we ask for confirmation. We ask for a sign because we don't know his voice, because we're listening to another voice. Watch this. He says, for since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God. The world did not know God. They think they know God. They think they got it all together. They think they have wisdom, but they don't have the wisdom that comes from God. He says, for my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human understanding. That's the wisdom of the world. Persuasive words of human understanding. But in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith should not be in the wisdom of men with persuasive words and human understanding, but in the power of God. In other words, the wisdom of God is not words. The wisdom of God is power. And we're lacking this wisdom today because all we have is knowledge. We have understanding. And for most of us who've been around, we have experiential knowledge. You know what experiential knowledge is, right? You live long enough, you'll gain wisdom through experience. That's not the wisdom of God. That's practical wisdom. Let me give you an example. If I look at the burner on my stove, and that burner is orange, it's high, and I touch that burner, my hand will be burnt. Now, knowledge says the burner is hot. Knowledge says if I touch it, I'll be burned. But wisdom says, don't touch it. Practical wisdom, right? So we gain wisdom through experiences on what is right and what is wrong. But that's not the wisdom of God. The wisdom of God is the power of God. Watch. The wisdom of God is foolishness. The message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us, it is the power of God. This is why the world cannot understand us. They can't understand the principle of seeing and believing. Because seeing and believing doesn't make sense to the carnal mind, because it's the wisdom of God. The world says, I have to see it, and then I will believe it. But God's wisdom says, no, it's the other way around. You have to believe it, and then you will see it. That's foolishness. See, the wisdom of God can get results quicker than knowledge can. See, we're still living by knowledge. We're still walking by knowledge and not wisdom of God. Jesus said to the disciples, speak to the mountain and tell the mountain to be removed. Well, that's foolishness. How can you speak to a mountain and tell it to be removed? But knowledge, watch this. Knowledge says that when we come up against the mountain, we gotta climb it. We gotta walk around it. We gotta dig a hole through it, all which takes time. But God says, just speak to it and it will be removed. That is foolishness. There's a woman by the Shunammite woman who was in debt and owed her creditors money. And a man of God named Elisha came to this woman and said, what do you have in your house? Now, most of us, when we are in debt, We go out and get a full-time job and three part-time jobs to try to pay off the debt. See, that's knowledge. That's going to take time. This woman had a debt to pay, and watch this, her miracle or the wisdom of God came to her, and Elisha told her, take the oil and go get more vessels and pour that oil into all those vessels. And after you're pouring the oil into all those vessels, go sell that oil and pay the debt. That's the wisdom of God. The wisdom of God always brings immediate results. When I read the scriptures, Jesus operated in a ministry for 3.5 years. He done more in 3.5 years than any ministry could ever do, because he operated in the wisdom of God. He told the leper, be cleansed. Immediately he was cleansed. He didn't tell the leper, go to the doctor, get a checkup, get a prognosis, wait 2 weeks, get a diagnosis, come back, have surgery, pay $10,000. No, the wisdom of God gets immediate results. All we need is a word of wisdom. And because we're not getting a word of wisdom, we default back into knowledge, our own understanding of how to get it done. Has God made foolish the wisdom of this world? Yes, he has, because they can't understand us. How can we believe and then receive? How can we proclaim a thing and declare it? All of these principles in the word of God, seek ye first the kingdom of God and all these things shall be added unto you. The world can't understand that. The world says you got to work for it. You got to go to school for it. You got to get a degree. You got to earn a degree. You got to pay off your debt. And then all these things. God says, listen, there's a wisdom that I have that if you put the kingdom of God first, all the things that you need in life will be added unto you. That's foolish. That's foolish. See, the wisdom of God is foolish. And God is calling for people, his people, to walk in wisdom, to walk in his foolishness. But the natural man, here it is, the carnal man, does not receive the things of the Spirit of God because they are foolishness to him. Nor can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. He can't understand it. You're just wasting your time trying to talk to a carnal man about spiritual things because it's foolishness to him. And for some things, our life is foolishness to us. All Adam and Eve had to do was just not listen. They were more blessed not knowing than knowing. Because once they ate the tree of life, tree of fruit of knowledge of good and evil, the whole thing caved in on them. Everything collapsed. They had everything they needed. All they had to do was just trust God and God will provide. Watch this. So after they fell, the ground got cursed, and now they had to work for their food. See, prior to that, they didn't have to work for their food. It was provided from God Almighty. But he says this. He says, cursed is the ground, talking to Adam, for your name's sake, in toil you shall eat of it. In other words, now, because you have disobeyed me by listening to your wife, the ground has been cursed, and now you got to work to get your food. All the days of your life, he says, in the sweat of your face, that's work, you shall eat bread till you return to the ground. For out of you were taken, dust you are, dust you shall return. That's the curse. Watch this. He fell upon Adam. To the woman, he said, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and conception, and in pain you shall bring forth children. Watch this. Your desire shall be for your husband. He shall rule over you. Watch what he said to the serpent. Because you have done this, you are cursed more than all cattle. I told you he was a beast. And more than every beast of the field, on your belly you shall go. Watch this. This is something. He says, I will put enmity between you and the woman. Notice he didn't say, I'll put enmity between you and the man. Enmity is deep hatred. He says, I'll put enmity between the serpent and the woman. Serpent and the woman. And between your seed, the serpent seed, and her seed. In other words, her offspring. Right? So we have here Eve being deceived, not Adam, fell into transgression, and now both of them got to pay the price. Why didn't God just say Eve would be the one that would receive the curse? Well, remember, Adam married his wife. God did not tell Adam to marry his wife. I know we've been told that, but he didn't tell her to marry. He presented a naked woman before Adam. Because men, we are visual creatures. We're not like women. We visualize. So when he saw the naked woman, what did he say? This is bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. In other words, this is my wife. And because he married Eve, they are now one. So therefore, God looks at them as one flesh, not two. So now they both got to pay the price for their transgression. Eve was deceived by the serpent, and Adam was deceived by his wife. Have you ever noticed that when a man falls from grace, it's always a woman? All across the board. In the church, in government, in politics. When a man falls, it's always a woman. Rarely can a man take another man down. Governors fall by women. Politicians fall by a woman. Judges fall by a woman. Pastors fall by women. Where do these women come from? They're just natural, ordinary women listening, hearing, talking to a serpent. Every time a man falls from grace, it's always a woman or women attached to that, pulling him down. Because a man can't pull another man down. It's a woman. That's what the devil is doing. He said, I'll put enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. In other words, when I want to bring a man down, I'm going to use a woman. This is the deliverance ministry. He goes on and he says to Adam, because you have heeded the voice of your wife and have eaten from the tree of knowledge of good and evil commanded, you shall not eat of it. You shall curse, the ground shall be cursed for you. I'm just making a point. I'm not trying to minimize women. Thank God for women. I just want women to understand the big picture of what's happening. I want women to be able to discern, who are you listening to? What is the voice that is talking to you? I know you hear God, but there's another voice hissing in the background. Conversation. Women like it. Affection. Women like it. A sense of feeling love. Women love it. Attention. Women love it. Self-validation. Women love it. Satan knows this, and he'll talk to you. He'll whisper in your ears. Even men know this. We know this. It's called rap. You rap. You got a good rap. She'll listen to it. You say the right things at the right time, she'll listen to it. Satan knew this. He knew how to charm this woman with his words. Men do it all the time. They charm women just by talk. You can talk yourself into a woman's heart just by just talking. She'll let her guard down and she'll listen to you. Satan was very shrewd, very clever in understanding the vibe and the rhythm of the woman. He said, let no man deceive himself. Don't deceive yourself. If anyone thinks that you be wise in this world, let him become a fool that he may be wise. In other words, when you come to God, all of your knowledge, all of your understanding has to go. You got to become a fool. You've got to get the wisdom of God, because your knowledge is going to set you back. What you know and what you think you know is going to hold you down. It's the wisdom of God that's going to promote you. It's the wisdom of God that's going to bring you success. It's the wisdom of God that's going to bring restoration, healing, and deliverance to your life, not your knowledge. It sets us back every single time, because we are still eating from the tree of knowledge. We just got to know. We got to connect the dots. Even when God does something in our life, you know what we do? We start thinking about it. Well, how did this happen? Well, this had to happen, and then this happened. And see, we start to, God says, you don't need to know. Just trust me. God just says, follow me. Trust me. You don't need to know. God blesses us with open opportunity, and we're sitting on a job we don't deserve. We'll get to thinking, how did we get here? Well, we put our resume in, and this knowledge, eating from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Listen to what James 2 and 16 says. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. That tree of knowledge was the world. It was in the Garden of Eden. How do you say the pride of life is the wisdom of the world? What is the wisdom of the world? Go to school, make a lot of money, be successful, get the nice house, get the nice car, do whatever it takes to cook, get ahead. That's the wisdom of this world. Is there anything wrong with that? Absolutely not. But the wisdom of God, watch this, says that if you seek ye first the kingdom of God, all these things shall be added unto you. You'll get it quicker. You won't have to put a lot of work in. Knowledge takes time. Knowledge takes money. Knowledge takes energy. Wisdom of God gets it just like that. Listen, the lust of the flesh. The tree was good for food. The lust of the eyes, it was pleasant to the eyes. A tree desirable to make one wise, there it is, the pride of life. I've attained, I've reached it, I'm successful, it is my doing, I did it, me, I didn't need anybody's help, I am pride of life. That tree of knowledge is still here today. And we could be eating from it. Adam and Eve went to the world. They went to the world in the Garden of Eden. They rejected the provision of God in the garden. They said, God, we want to know. We don't trust you anymore. We want to know. We want to be like you, to know good and evil. And when their eyes were opened, the Bible says, they knew they were naked. In other words, the glory vanished. It disappeared. And they ran and hid in the bushes. The Bible says that they sowed fig leaves amongst themselves to try to hide from God. In the bushes. Isn't it strange how when sin comes in our life, we hide from God? Or we'll make every excuse not to do anything for God. Sin will always be exposed when glory dwells. Always. Glory always exposes sin. You've ever been to an anointed church with the Spirit of God? We get convicted of our sin. We'll make excuses after excuses. I've seen people squirm in their seat under a heavy anointing because of the convicting power of God. I myself have been convicted in an anointed service by the preaching of an anointed preacher. Because glory, watch this, or the spirit of glory will always convict of sin. He'll always expose your sin. They ran after they sinned and hid in the bushes to the point that they tried to camouflage themselves by making fig leaves and sewing it on fig leaves to look like a tree. Even the tree knew that they weren't trees. Cursed the ground for your sake and toil. You shall eat of it all the days of your life. In the sweat of your face, you shall eat bread till you return. God was angry at the woman, but man, Adam had to pay for it because he married her. He said, this is bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. He was saying, we are married. We are one. He says, I will put enmity between you and the woman and between your seed and her seed. Satan is not after the woman. Never was, never will be. He's after the seed. He's after the male image. This is why our young black men are dying. Because that is the image in the earth that Satan is corrupting. He's trying to destroy the male image, not the woman image. He's after the man. He's always been after the man. Whether I can take the man down through a woman or I'll gun him down on the street, but he's after the male image. He wants to change the man or the male image. Watch this. He wants to change it. This is the deliverance ministry. Hear me. Revelations 12:13. Now when the dragon saw that he had been cast to the earth, he persecuted the woman who gave birth to the male child. Now John is calling this serpent beast a dragon. He persecuted the woman. Didn't kill the woman. He just persecuted her because she was about to bring forth a male child. Verse 17 says, and the dragon was enraged. Here's the enmity. I will put enmity between you and the woman, enraged with the woman, and went to make war with the rest of her offspring, her seed. Just like I told you, the males. The image, the dragon. I wish I had a picture of a dragon. I would show you. I'll put it up on the wall and show you a dragon. I just told you that this thing that was Paul was talking about was had wings. It had 4-foot beast. Watch this. He said, and change the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man. Watch this. And birds and 4-footed beasts and creeping things. The creeping things would be the serpent, the birds and the 4-foot. If you've ever seen a dragon, I'll put it up. A dragon is a beast that has wings, has a head like a snake, and has a tongue like a snake that's divided. That's the image. What does Satan look like? Am I saying Satan looks like that? I don't know. I never seen him. But this beast, this image, whatever he looks like, Paul is giving us a description. He's saying that this beast that's in the garden, or this beast that's now, John said it looks like a dragon. It looks like a 4-footed animal with wings, with the head of a snake. Revelation 12:4. And the dragon, Satan, stood before the woman who was ready to give birth to devour, there it is, kill, her child as soon as it was born, the male child. So there's an image that Satan is corrupting and has corrupted in the earth, and it is the male image. Verse 4 in Revelation 13. So they worship the dragon who gave authority to the beast, and they worship the beast. They worship the beast. The glory has been changed. The glory, not the outshining radiance of God that has been changed, but the praise and the honor and the worship has shifted. Satan has shifted the glory that's supposed to go to God to himself, to the beast. It's been changed. It's changing. Because Satan does not like, watch this, the image of man, because the image of man is a likeness or a reflection of God. So he's changed it. He's distorted it. How does he distort it and change it? Look at the men. Look at how effeminate they are. He changes it. Men don't look like men. He's changed it through homosexuality. He's changing it through transgenderism. This is the image of Satan. He is both male and female. I know this is the hardest one. He changes the image right before our eyes, and we don't notice it. We know something's going on, but we don't know. We don't know why or the purpose of. He doesn't like the image, because he used to be in the image when he was Lucifer. But when he was cast down out from heaven, he lost that image. And now the Bible calls him the dragon. All right. He changed the glory. It is the word doxia, which means honor, praise, and worship. And he has made it into an image made like a man with wings like a bird, four-footed animal that creeps on the ground. So you have the world, or you have those who are unsaved who are worshiping the dragon. They're worshiping an image. It is not the image of God. It is the image of our adversary, the devil. They serve him, because he's making promises. Watch this. He's making promises just like he did in the Garden of Eden. He says, you will not surely die, for God knows in the day that you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. That's a promise. Where do we get this thing about he's always lying? No, he's not. Satan has got promises, and people are buying into those promises and selling out to those promises to worship him, to worship this beast, this serpent-like beast image. Oh, they even know it's the devil, but because of his promises and what he can offer them and what he can give them, they sell out. And they began to look like him. Men, effeminate men. Men who look like women. Satan is a freak of nature. When he got cursed, his body changed. He does not look like a human. And now you have men who are changing right before our very eyes into his image. Because Satan has to put his image in the earth in order to dominate the earth. I wish I can go into detail about that, but I began to read about the story of Babel and how they built that temple, or that tower rather, to reach toward heaven. And I began to study that scripture, and I began to hear God say that tower was designed to reach heaven so that Satan can go back into heaven and war with God because he's still angry that he's been cast down. That tower was so tall that it would take a year just to get to the top, they said. He's still trying to get back into heaven. He still wants to fight with God, but he knows he can't fight with God. He knows he can't get to heaven, rather. So he said, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll corrupt your image down here on earth until you get mad enough to come down to earth and fight me here. The Bible calls it the Battle of Armageddon. Read it. It's in the book of Revelation. I'll corrupt God's image. I'll steal his glory. Just like I wanted to do, Satan. Steal the glory. Steal the honor. Steal the worship. And I'll have them worship me instead of you, God. That's what Satan is saying. He's changing the glory right before our very eyes. And he still has a fight and battle with God. And he's pushing God's buttons. I'll kill your male children until you come down and fight with me. Oh, it's going to come. There's a war coming. Once God gets tired of what Satan is doing here on the earth and corrupting his image, he's coming down. He's coming down to fight. Watch this. Change the glory. He changed the glory. He switched it. He transforms it. He's taking it to another direction because he don't want glory in the church. He wants glory someone else. So he's put a superficial false glory in the church today. That's not the glory of God. That's man's wisdom. That's man building up his own wisdom to create a false glory. Don't you see it? That's not glory in the church. And churches are deceived because they are still eating from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. We got to make it look like God is here. We got to put the lights. We got to put the strobe lights. We got to create this background. We got to have all this stuff to make it look like God's glory. It's a fake glory in the church. People are falling for it because they don't recognize the devil. They are ignorant of his devices. We've studied too much about God and not about the devil. Nobody wants to talk about it. Listen. God's image has been corrupted. Satan hates the image of God because it reminds him of what he used to look like. The world thinks that they are wise in making this exchange for the truth of God and buying the lie. That's what Romans says. They buy in the lie. They bought the lie. They don't want to know the truth. Tell us a lie. We'll believe a lie because the truth hurts. The truth causes for sacrifice. The truth causes me to give up something. The truth causes me to deny myself. And I like my little gods in my house. I want to choose my God. This is what the world says. I want to choose my God and serve whatever kind of God I want. I don't want the true and living God. I want my own gods. God of money, God of pleasure, God of sex, God of prosperity, God of wealth, God of everything. I want my own gods. That's the lie. God says they profess to be wise, but they are fools. Watch this. Therefore, God gave them up. Here it is. Up to uncleanness in the lusts of their hearts to dishonor their bodies among themselves. This is what the image of, this is what these men are doing. They're dishonoring their bodies through the lust of themselves with one another, committing what is shameful. Men with men. And receiving the penalty of their error in due time. Whether they get it in this lifetime or the next lifetime. Watch this. And watch this. And exchange the truth of God. Verse number 25. For the lie and worship and serve, here it is, the creature, the dragon, the beast, rather than the creator. Who we're serving? Are we serving God? Are we serving the beast and don't know? Are we seeking this knowledge, this understanding by senses? Hey, are we governing our life by what we see, smell, taste, and touch? Or are we operating in the wisdom of God? Homosexuality has corrupted the image of God. It doesn't look like God. Bisexual, transgenderism, all effeminate is what Satan desires to corrupt the world with his image. Man is created in the image of God. Man. This is the book of the genealogy of Adam. In the day that God created man, he made him in the likeness of God. Him. That's why Satan is after him, not her. He's after him because he is the image of God. For indeed, a man ought not to cover his head, since he is the image and glory of God. But woman is the glory of man. For man is not from woman, but the woman is from man. For the woman was from man, even so man is also through the woman. How does that? Through. She gives birth. It comes through the birth canal. Man comes through woman. But woman is from man. She was taken out of his side. Image has been corrupted. Satan is corrupting this image, the male image. Wisdom, the wisdom of God, needs to be talked about. It needs to be preached. It needs to be taught. We need to understand and start walking in wisdom because we are not getting results like we should. We're still operating in knowledge. Understanding, trying to make it work, trying to make it happen, when all we need is a word of wisdom, a word from the Lord, a word of wisdom to handle the situation correctly with results and speed. Because a word of wisdom can do much for you in a matter of minutes than knowledge can ever can. And we spend all our life walking in knowledge, but not receiving a word of wisdom for our situation, when all it takes is just like that, and it can happen. The male image has been corrupted. Satan is after the male. He's killing the males. This is the dragon that is ready to devour the woman, devour the child that comes out of the woman immediately. Because he knows that that male is created in the image and the likeness of God, and he hates it. So we need to do something about it. How do we do something about it? First, what we need to do is go back to the Garden of Eden and say, Lord, I'm going to trust you. I don't need to know what you're doing. I don't need to eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil anymore. I don't want to see in the spirit realm. You ain't got to show me a sign. I just trust. Because I'm more blessed not knowing. I don't need to connect the dots. I don't need to try to figure things out to see how they're going to work. I just need a word of wisdom. I just need you to drop the word of wisdom in my spirit, so I can handle this situation, so that I can receive a blessing, so that I can prosper. A word. All I need is a word of wisdom. That's where we begin. And not trying to connect the dots to everything by eating from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. We don't need to know. Just says trust. Don't need to know. It may take time because, see, we are subconsciously need to know. It's built in us to want to know. How am I going to get there? Who's going with me? How much money does it take? It's a part of life. So that's what the Bible says. We need to be renewed in the spirit, in the thinking of our mind, because our minds have been already programmed to go after knowledge, to keep going, to eat from this tree. Show me a sign. Let me see in the realm of the spirit. No. If God don't show you anything, keep it closed. This is where we begin. We began to demonstrate this, and we began to teach our young men how to be men. It's not up to them to decide on who they want to be. And that's what's happening in the world today. You got people deciding on what gender they want to be today. They don't want to be a man. They want to be a woman. And the woman want to be a man. They decide. That's the beginning of it. And we're going to have a lost generation in years to come. So lost that you can decide on what you want to be. Who gives you that right to decide that? He's corrupting this image because he hates the image of God. He wants the glory, just like he did from the beginning. He wants to be worshiped and praised, just like he did. He's behind the scenes orchestrating this whole thing. And women need to be careful of what you're listening to. You got to be careful of what you're hearing. You got to be careful of social media. You got to be careful of what you're watching, because remember, he is the prince of the power of the air. The air what? The airwaves, the frequencies. He's on radio. He's on TV. He's on the internet. He is on the airwaves, and he's hissing. He's hissing in our ears. And if you listen, you stay listening, he's going to pull you into some type of deception. And once he pulls you into that type of deception, he's going to use you. And when he's finished using you, he's going to spew you out of his mouth. Women, pay attention to the voice. We're torn all our life between these two voices, not just women. I don't want to make this statement. Men too. There's another voice listening. There's another voice that's speaking to us. A hissing voice, the serpent's voice in the background. When God speaks, we ought to know it's God speaking. We should not have to question God to say whether it was you or not. That's an indication that you don't know his voice. Adam did not question God when God said, "Where art thou, Adam?" He knew the voice of God. He said, "I heard your voice and I ran and hid in the bushes." He didn't say, "Is that you, God? Is this you speaking to me, Lord?" We've got to discern the voice of God. How do you discern the voice of God? It's very easy. Just tune out all the other voices. Pray. Get into the word. You'll hear his voice and it'll become clear and you'll recognize it. We may never get to 100%. We may get to 99%, but that's good enough. As long as we can recognize the voice of the enemy and the voice of God, we can't mix the two. We got to know when it's God talking, and we got to know when it's the devil talking. If we don't, we are going to fall into deception, and we are going to be just like Eve, pulled down. We got to protect our black men. We got to support our black men, and we got to make sure our black men are men that carry the image of God in the earth. And with that, I'm going to close. Thanks again, David Jones, More Excellent Ministries. I won't be on next Sunday. I'll be on the following Sunday to come before you again live Facebook. Have a blessed week. May the peace of God that surpasses all understanding guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Peace be unto you, and peace be multiplied.